I was born in Los Angeles, California in 1928, and I went to three schools in Los Angeles, elementary school, 49th Street, junior high school was McKinley High, changed the name when I graduated to George Washington Carver, and Jefferson High School. And I graduated from there in 1946. And tried at that time to continue my education by going to City College, majoring in civil engineering. But I just had too big of a load to carry, and I convinced myself that I just wasn't smart enough. So I said I needed a better plan. My plan was to go and work and save some money and then go back to school. And that didn't quite work out. First of all, I couldn't find a job. I looked all over LA for a job. As you can remember, in 1946, 47, all our men from over in the service was coming home. The wars were over. We had an abundance of skill workers, and a kid out of high school didn't have too much of a chance. I ran into, first time in my life, the discriminatory practice in this country, and it hit me when I was looking for work. So I just worked a little harder. I had a choice of doing one or two things, because I didn't have a choice about was I going to live on. I figured that God give me, He put me here, and I'm supposed to stay here. And so I was going to live on no matter who or how, but I didn't want to take anything from anybody, and I didn't want to hurt anybody. So I really worked hard at trying to find a job, and it's amazing that I kind of thought this through way back then. And I took all kind of state civil service exams, and I talked to all kind of people about opportunity, and I just kept getting the door slammed in my face. I was fortunate. I took one test for the Department of Justice as a fingerprint technician. Not that I was eager to be a fingerprint technician, but this was a job, and I could make a living, I felt, doing whatever I could do. And I did pass that exam high enough that they called me. They called me to come from LA, Los Angeles, all the way to Sacramento to go to work, and I just thought, at first I thought that was not going to happen. It was just too big of a reach. But nothing else happened. I never got a job, so I thought I better look at this a little more serious. So I did. I came up here, and the Department of Justice was, they were looking for me. They wanted me to go to work for them, so I did. Started February 48, and I worked for about 10 years for that department. When I started, I told them I was interested in engineering and I was going to go back to school and study engineering. And everybody was applauding me, saying, great, encourage me, you go to school and you can make something of yourself. But as I would tell a person when I see them and he says to me how things are going, and I'm saying, well, I'm still trying to get back into college. And they just started looking, after the first 5 years of saying that, they started looking at me like I, you know, you got to be kidding. We don't want to discourage you, but, you know, what a joke. Well, the way it happened, after I was there for almost 10 years, I was getting to be 30, and I said, I got to make a move if I'm going to do it. And I started taking exams for doing drafting work, and I passed the one for junior drafting aid. There's not a lower position than that, but the job was in Los Angeles again. And by that time, I was married, and I had three kids and a wife. And she never worked. She was just a home wife that took care of the kids, and which is a lot of work in itself. I got a trailer, and I packed six rooms of furniture in that trailer and hauled it down to Los Angeles, and we set up a living there. And I went to work for Division of Highways, which that was the name then, which now it's Caltrans, same place. And I worked there for 18 months. The weather, the smog, and everything was bad on my oldest child, and so I said, we better leave here. And that gave me that was one of the motivators for me coming back to Sacramento, because I thought it was okay here. And that's when I tried to transfer from Division of Highways in LA to Division of Highways in Sacramento. But I said, I better look at some other state agencies. Bob Adams said, well, Shirley, when can you come to work? Can you start tomorrow? And that was kind of talk I wanted to hear. So I said, yeah, so, which I took up. And that was just that was one of the best moves I ever made. So I look at the way things have worked out. They built Sac State. Sac State was started back in 1947 or 48. And they started at the City College campus. And then they moved to where they are now. And it's like everything got to be done on time. And that was done right on time for me to come to work for Water Resources and find a situation that made it possible for me to go to school. A lot of the tests that we ran in the lab, they had to be finished up in so many days. And sometimes those so many days would end up on a Saturday or a Sunday. I said, you know, I don't mind coming in on Saturday or Sunday or working late. I don't mind doing that if you guys will let me offer the hours I need to take the class in physics and chemistry, because those classes had labs and you had to be there in the daytime. And so we worked it out. I worked at the lab for 8 years, and all those years I was going to school. In 1965, I got my degree in civil engineering. And Sac State was not an accredited university at the time. But that was okay. That was the best I had. I mean, it's right in my backyard. I better go here, you know. But the year I graduated, it became an accredited college at that time. So I get all the credit for graduating from it was ECPD. That was the initials they used for the accreditation board. I got my degree, and then I said, I've been up late night and studying, and I had my family. I tried not to push them in the background. I tried to do what I needed to do for the family. So I was burning the candle pretty on both ends. And when I got my degree, I decided, I'm going to get a physical that will tell me I'm in excellent health, I would hope, just tired and get some rest. And I got this physical, the doctor came back and said, gee, we see a spot on your lungs, we don't know what that is, but it shouldn't be there. And I said, wow. So King Cole had just died from lung cancer, you know, so something to really kind of be worried about. And I was smoking cigarettes at the time. And they went to the operation, and they found it wasn't cancers, it was a spore. Some of the soil down in the San Joaquin Valley carries this little spore that if you breathe it in your lung, it kind of, your body sees it and it attacks it like it's a germ, and it builds something around it, and that shows up on the x-ray. And the doctors thought it was like a miracle, you know, because he was so sure it was cancer. So he said, well, Shelly, that's a miracle. It was like a blessing, Ernie, because I was just so busy, and they said, you got San Joaquin Valley fever, you're going to have an operation. You know, that dust of your life, it stops everything. And you just go and you lay in the bed, and you get a chance to sleep and think about stuff. And part of my thinking was, you know, I got my degree in engineering. Now I owe it to myself and all these people who helped me to become an engineer, a real engineer. So I don't know if I would have got to the same point if I didn't have the time or period that I was laying in the bed. I told Bob Adams, that, you know, San Joaquin Valley fever, we were testing aggregates from all, you know, for the aqueduct all up and down the valley. And I said, some of the aggregates may have brought the spore in. I said, so it could be a job-related thing. And Bob Adams, I don't think so. He was a tough guy. He surely wouldn't want to put the state at any disadvantage. Yeah, I don't think so. Well, anyway, the big thing is that I didn't recover from it. So when I came back to work, that was the first thing I told Bob Adams, is that I want some more experience. I want experience in construction and in design, you know, so I can fulfill the requirements of really becoming an engineer. And maybe that was a bad day for him, I don't know, but he just got... He just was so upset with me. He says, if you want to leave here, you just don't want to, you don't have to. I told him I would look for another spot. And I went through the whole thinking. You know, I said, you know, I said, if Bob doesn't want to go for it, I said, then what are you going to do? And so I said, I just have to leave the lab, go out and find another job. I left Department of Water Resources. The reason why I left is because the workload started changing. We didn't have the projects that we thought we were going to have. We lost the peripheral canal, and we haven't built that thing yet. It's really necessary. I have to say it every time I talk to people. It's really necessary that we build a peripheral canal. We lost the San Joaquin Master Drain. And even more important, that needs to be finished. And because of the loss of those projects, we had other engineers that were being threatened. You know, my situation was that I had so many years of experience, even though it wasn't with water resources, all of it. Anyway, I could have probably stayed forever, I guess. But I said, if we're going to build these things, then I go find someplace else that's going to be doing something. So that's how I left Water Resources. I went to work for Division of Highways again. The American Concrete Institute, which is still an ongoing organization now, they put out a publication every month. And it was full of wealth of information. And Bob Adams would have Tuthill's copy, read it, and pass it on to me. Anybody else in the lab that would want to read it. And so it happened, I would read the whole thing. I mean, I was just interested in finding out what I could. And I would make my little comments on the index. I said, I'm gonna come back and ask Bob about this. And they were reading my comments, and they would ask questions based a lot of them on my comments. So it was really a great opportunity. We had one situation that occurred in one of the diversion tunnels for Oroville Dam. There's this tunnel that they carve out of the rock along the side of the dam, and so that the water would have a way to keep on flowing while they built the dam. And so the diversion tunnel is a very important element of your total structure. And they were going along with it really, really well, and they hit a point where the concrete stopped hardening. Did not harden. They didn't know what was wrong. And so Bob Adams brought the problem to the lab, and we tried adding different admixtures to it and different things. And we finally discover that if you added a little more gypsum to the cement, it would harden again normally. And we found that out at the lab. And we wrote a paper for ACI. And so I got a paper that says Shelly Bailey on it. I got a lot of papers that says Shelly Bailey on it. This paper that we wrote, we got credit for doing the work. And we did the work, you know, so. I got a lot of credit for it, for that discovery all throughout the country, you know, so along with Bob Adams and Ron Smith. So I gave a series of lectures all up and down the state on quality assurance, quality control. I gave two lectures, and I was followed up by another fellow who's from industry who gave two lectures. I talked about the statistics, and he talked about the practical ways of doing it. And we were a great team, and people were, and we got a lot of comments, good comments about our lecture that we gave, 4 days. And the classes averaged like maybe 75 to a class. And we gave them all up and down the state. That was one. The other lectures I gave, though, I taught the course in concrete out at Sac State for 6 years. The one class they wouldn't let me take to get my degree. So then the professor said, well, Shelly knows more about it than I do, and I don't want him in my class. And he was quite right. I did know a lot more about it than he did. And he suggested I take another course in geology, which worked out great.
They did give you credit for that.
And they gave me credit for the concrete. But then I think the school was very smart, because the next day they turned around and said, well, Shelly, would you teach the class? If you don't think you know anything about it beforehand, and you teach it, then you learn what you didn't know. If I hadn't worked for Water Resources, I never would have gotten the experience to the depth and the level I got, so I could go out and teach it. This country got many different faces, because there could have been a situation where I would have been discouraged all the way around. And I did run into discouraging situations. I had one supervisor that did not really encourage me. And maybe the discouragement wasn't against me per se, but when I was elected president of the American Society of Civil Engineers, I was still an associate engineer.
Sacramento
section. Yeah, right. Not the whole national thing. But Sacramento is big enough. The Sacramento section is 1/4 of California. It was conceivable that I would be needing to spend some time for the engineering work. And my supervisor told me, no, Charlie, you're not a senior. But I was on the list, Ernie, for four senior jobs, as I think back. One of them was at the lab. And I didn't argue with him any. He told me how uncomfortable he felt with me taking advantage of being elected to this position. And I said, well, you know, I said, don't worry about it. I said, I can relieve you of that worry by just retiring. Because I could retire at age 50. And that was like in a couple of months. So I just retired. If he was looking out for me and the state, he would have made the arrangements that they did make for the other guy that got elected to the president of the Sacramento section, who was also an associate engineer, just like I was. But he was also on the list. And so what they did, they just scrambled and got him appointed to a senior position so that he could do that job in both jobs. But I don't know. I always felt like I got to carry my own load. If I'm going to cause a person to be uncomfortable, either we get it settled one way or the other. And there was one way to settle it. I could just retire, which I did. So I retired pretty young at 50, which kind of caught me up with myself. you know, and I went into business for myself, which is also something I wanted to do. When I went to work for the Department of Justice, I think I was the third black person ever hired by that department. And that department had was kind of known for not being open to everybody. They were being challenged by the NAACP and some other people. So when I came up there for my interview, they were glad to see me, and they just took me right on in. And one of the statements the man made, which I was kind of surprised, he says, "Shelly, you won't be discriminated here against. You won't be discriminated against." I thought that was a very strange statement, because this idea of being discriminated against was something I never bought anyway, you know, so why would you even, I didn't think I would be, you know, so. But anyway, I was. And Ernie, maybe because, you know, engineers kind of study a lot. And even before I was an engineer, I was always doing that. I was studying a lot. So when I got enough experience to take the exam for the intermediate fingerprint technician, I was a junior fingerprint technician. That's how they hired me. Then when I got enough experience to become intermediate fingerprint technician, I just started reading about identification. I read all about the different methods and the one that the French had for measuring the bones. And anyway, I took the test. I did very well on it. I did super well. I came out number one, and I got appointed right away. So that was, no, that was what you would expect. That's normal. But when I got qualified, when I was qualified to become a senior, and that place gave that exam once every 4 years. And if you didn't make it, you got to wait another 4 years. You don't put too many 4 years together before you're an old person. But when I took the exam for a senior fingerprint technician, I studied for it like normal. Everybody passed the oral interview except one person. And guess who that was? And I recognized, well, maybe I don't talk too well. And I didn't know exactly what was going on, other than I felt like I was being discriminated against. But then I went down and looked at my score. My score was the highest score in the whole state of California. I mean, my score was, the guy who was number one on the list, my score was several, maybe 10 points higher than his. And I thought, and I figured it out, well, we're going to have to do something about this. We're going to say we've been discriminated against, or we're going to argue that we should have passed, and somebody overlooked our ability or something. And I talked to the personnel board. They got, I don't know, five people sitting up there on their high bench. And when I talked to them, and I said, they just made a mistake. And how do you say they made a mistake? Well, first of all, my written score was good enough to show you that I knew something about the subject. And I said, and second, when a senior is missing from his section during the regular work time, they asked me a lot of time to come and fill in for him, which I did. And so I said, I work as a senior many times, and nobody's ever complained about what I did. And one of the members on the personnel board just said, well, I'll make a motion, we pass this guy. And that's all he had to do. So I got passed, put me number one on the list, but they never appointed me. So I sat there for almost 4 years, and they were about ready to give another test. And that was talking about getting into engineering, and nothing ever happened. And then I have to take this test again. That's what I needed, was that little push. I'm afraid, Ernie, if they had given me that position, I wouldn't have never taken the next step to get into engineering. So discrimination is bad, but sometimes it makes you do what you need to do. I didn't have to declare war, so, and I came out, I think, way ahead. whether it's a racial discrimination or a person just don't like you. You know, you got the same problem. But we are free people, and that's one of my, that's my thing, is that we're free people, and if you aren't gutsy enough to find what you, you know, the place you should be, or make this place where you are the place you should be, then that's part of our responsibility to do that. I understand we got this problem, and we gotta keep working on it. The main thing is that if the door is open for you to walk in, you might be able to get everything else straightened out after you get inside. If you're doing something useful, that's a great way of making a living. And I would just encourage everybody who is interested, whether minority or not, to look at this and as a field to make a living and try to make a better world.